Hello, everyone. We're going to get started in just a few minutes. We're going to let everybody get a chance to get connected and join us. And so we'll be starting in just a few minutes. Okay, I think we're ready to get started now. I want to welcome everyone to our webinar today, to the five practices. My name is Sherry Moore. I'm part of the business development team here in executive education. And we're going to cover this topic today, as well as some of our other programs that we offer. But first, I just wanted to get started with a little bit of an overview of what we do in executive education. We're going to cover today, as I mentioned, the five practices. We're going to talk a little bit about the two programs that we offer in the Tuesday night sessions. We'll also talk a little bit about the registration process, who the key contacts are, and I want to save time, of course, for Q&A. So I want to make sure that you are directed to the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. If you would please send lots of questions our way, we would love to be able to answer them either during the sessions or at the end. There is both a chat and a Q&A, but we prefer it if you would use the Q&A button at that time. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the Cox SMU Advantage. We are now a business school that's been around for 100 years, celebrating that on February 20th of 2020. We've been an integral part of the business community. We have proven instructors that are tested and true. We have a commitment to leadership development and to performance. We have a collaborative working method with companies and individuals to assure success, and we have a high value investment in our leadership development. So what makes our approach different? Well, we are training business leaders, both for individuals and for corporations. We are incorporating principles and techniques that include active participation, reflection, a sharing of experiences, a variety of learning methods. Our instructors have credibility, humility, and respect. So when you ask people, why did they choose SMU Cox Executive Education for a program? This is what we hear back, is that our faculty are experts in their field. They have relevant content that is based in the latest research, innovative tools they can put to work today. They are collaborating and networking with diverse sets of colleagues while they are here on campus, as well as how we may be doing this virtually in the future. And it is a safe and challenging learning environment to think and to test new ideas. So at this point, I'm going to introduce Jeff Stresa, and then Jeff's going to launch us into the five practices. This is one of the sessions that we teach in the Transformational Leadership Program, one of the 10. So I think he's going to give you a good overview of the five sessions. But Jeff is an organizational development consultant focused on multi-generational family enterprises, corporations, and mission-driven nonprofit organizations. He has more than 25 years experience working across industries in the areas of leadership development, organizational effectiveness, and family dynamics. He holds certifications in family wealth and family business advising. And Jeff has served as the Chief Talent and Learning Officer at Tolleson Wealth Management, which is a multifamily office serving client families across the country. And prior to his role at Tolleson, Jeff served as the Chief Human Resources Officer at Southern Methodist University. He has taught both undergraduate and graduate level courses as an adjunct faculty member in SMU's Cox School of Business. In addition to teaching in several of our programs, Jeff currently serves as academic director for an award-winning program, a leadership development program for one of our corporate clients. So at this point, I want to introduce Jeff, and thank you for being here, and I'll let you begin discussing the five practices.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to be with you virtually, and I know that we all hope to be together again soon in person and be a part of these programs here in the Collins Center at SMU. I'm really thrilled to be here today to talk about a topic that I have a lot of passion about, specifically this course of study, the five leadership practices, which is one of my favorites to teach here at SMU. I've been doing it for a long time, and it's based on a book by Jim Kouzes and Barry Posner. What I'm going to do basically is kind of talk through and kind of give you an overview of the program, of the practices, and you'll in a moment you'll begin to see slides and some of the tenets, the commitments, and the behaviors that is encompassed in this program. But it's really kind of an overview, and as you listen and read the slides, it's an opportunity for you to do almost a kind of a quick personal assessment to consider what are some things that you're already good at, that you already have instinctually or you've worked at in your career. And you'll also see some opportunities where you may want to grow. And obviously that's why we all want to come to a learning environment where you want to continuously grow as leaders. The five practices are an incredible body of work that has really stood the test of time. The authors are steeped in academia and research, but they've also had lots of practical experience working in business and industry. The practices, as I said, are well-researched. They're really based on universal principles, so it's really not so much around theory. It's really about practical, behavioral kinds of strategies that you can take no matter where you are in your career, whether you are a individual contributor right now and you want to grow in your leadership capacity there, part of a team, or you have some sort of a manager level responsibility and you want to continue to become sharper as a supervisor and a coach of others. So I really encourage you to engage your mind and imagination over the next 45 minutes. I do want to share with you on the front end a quote from the book. This quote is from the book, and I think it's interesting to consider what does it mean to aspire? What does it mean to aspire and be willing to bring others into something you're passionate about? And that's part of this whole discussion on leadership, is how do we bring others along? Because leadership really, you can be a leader no matter where you are in your life, in the home, in the community, in your office, in your organization. Management has a certain criteria and title and tasks and responsibilities, but you can be a manager and not necessarily be a great leader. And I think that's one of the things SMU is very passionate about doing, is helping people grow in both management and leadership skills. This specific course of study is around leadership. So it's many of the communication and clarity and qualitative skills, if you will. One thing I would ask you to do during this webinar is just think about all of the change we're going through over these last months and a lot of the adversity that our society is going through. It's a time where I find many people become very reflective about what's most important to them in the home and in the workplace. It's a time where a lot of us dig deep and look for meaning in things, and that is when we need leadership the most, especially when there's grief or loss or change going on. These are hard times, and we tend to grow the most, I believe, when we go through adversity. I've done a lot of leadership development programs and a lot of coaching over the years, and sometimes I've seen people grow the most when they're faced with change or they're going through something that is difficult in their life. So a discussion on leadership seems more relevant than ever right now. People look to leaders during times of uncertainty, and so my challenging question to you is, how can you be a leader to someone or some group of people in your life right now, how can you sharpen yourself? Let's take a look at the five leadership practices. By studying and living out these practices, what I would say is you really earn the right to be called a leader, right? It's being a leader is an earned sort of disposition, the way others perceive you. It's, you know, it's not very humble to say, you know, I'm a great leader. It's when other people say that about you, then that is an amazing amount of credibility that you've earned. It's about being perceived as someone who people will want to follow. As I mentioned before, it's not a theory. It's a collection of practices. It's behavioral. In fact, if you look at this slide here, you see to the right side, you see this rock with trust on it. And what's important about these five leadership practices is sequence. And we're going to talk about the sequence and why it's so important that we learn to practice these ultimately over time to where they become more instinctual for us. The more we practice, the more instinctual they become for us. And the byproduct of practicing these things over time leads to trust. When you're in a leadership role, trust really becomes the currency for why people would want to follow you. You can leverage authority in management positions. And sometimes we need to do that. Sometimes we need to be able to delegate. We need to be able to supervise. We need to be able to correct and redirect people. However, in order to really create employee engagement with your teams or trust with your coworkers, you'll need to be willing to be a constant learner, to be humble. And when you do assume authority, to be able to put others first so that they see you as a servant leader. That to me is what leadership really is all about. As I mentioned, sequence is everything here. You won't be effective enabling others to act, which is the fourth practice here. It's all about delegation and empowerment and really getting people to do things alongside you or for you. You won't be able to really do that well over time if you don't practice the other behaviors prior to that about modeling the way, inspiring the vision, and so forth. Each practice is comprised of two commitments. And as we look at the two commitments under Model the Way, what you'll see here are some key words that I want to point out to you. And I think one of them is just clarifying your values. Sometimes it's simple to say that we have values, or here are our values, here are our company values, here's what we stand for. But ultimately, people look to leaders for those of us that live out those values. We live them out, we practice them, even when people aren't looking, even when it's hard, even when we're going through adversity. For example, a lot of people say, well, one of my values is fairness or trust or integrity. And sometimes when I've been coaching managers who have gone through some sort of difficulty in their career and their emotions sort of get the best of them and they really don't, they're not their best selves. In other words, they're blunt or they go inward or they're just not their best selves. And in a way, that's a way of sort of not living out your values for other people. Not that we all don't have human moments or we all don't make mistakes. We do. But leaders tend to course correct quickly. They make amends. We apologize. We do those kinds of things. I think the other thing here is just aligning your actions with your values, which is kind of what we're talking about here, walking your talk and making sure that you are consistently who you say you want to be. Let's look at the behaviors under Model the Way, because that's when we really get a lot more granular about the specific practice. As you scan these behaviors, I'm not going to read all of the bullet points to you. You can read those as we go along, but I want you to do a quick pulse on areas you have strength and confidence. And maybe choose at least one of those that you could improve on or you'd like to learn more about. And again, that's why we offer these courses of study, so you can come in and practice and be amongst peers and really go through a wonderful adult learning model that we've set up in these programs. For example, I can think of a leader I've worked with fairly recently and coached for actually a couple of years. She was very knowledgeable and good in her job, but had a few blind spots in her style, in her communication style. She did a great job of setting a personal example of what was to be expected and the quality standards that people needed to adhere to. However, The team often felt discouraged by the workload, the rigor of the job, and she started having turnover problems. So I began to coach her and to work on some of these. She felt like, hey, I feel like I'm being clear, I'm being fair-minded. But one of the things that she learned through coaching is that she really tended to come across too blunt and non-caring, especially during times of stress. So we worked together on that specific skill that she could still be direct and be empathic when that was needed. And that is a real example of the kind of training and education you'll get through programs like this. The balance of being a good manager, a good project lead, while balancing these leadership skills like listening and empathy. We worked on this for a couple of years, she and I, over time. And what we began to see is she began to retain her employees more. Specifically, she was able to build consensus around the goals of the project. And it was hard for her at first, but she really grew a lot because she humbled herself, she listened to others, she asked for feedback. And those are all the kinds of behaviors that are important in this first practice model, The Way. One specific book I would recommend you look at as you listen to some of these comments today on the webinar, there's a book called Humility is the New Smart. And the authors are Hess and Ludwig. I'd really recommend you look at that. It's an excellent read. It's been written in the last couple of years. And it's really employers who are hiring and promoting talent are increasingly looking at people skills and humility and empathy and things like that. Let's look at the next slide and let's consider for just a moment who you would follow willingly. Who would you follow willingly? Think of someone you've worked for in the past or a past authority, a teacher, a coach, even a family member that you would be willing to follow again. What kind of attributes do they possess and why did they earn your trust? I think it's important to reflect upon these things on the front end of courses like this, when we are really going deep into a learning mode or an exploration about how am I going to grow as a leader. We've got to start with the real basics. What were our influences? Who influenced us and why? Who is following you right now? Who in your home? Who in your work team? Who in your office is following you right now? And how can you be a positive influence on their growth? So now we're gonna segue into the second practice, because we got a really good feel now of, you gotta walk your talk. You gotta be clear on your values. You've gotta really balance this idea of managing tasks and people with ultimately living out your values and being a role model for people. So, inspire a shared vision is a really important part of leadership. It is really a practice where leaders need to be able to, I would say, look around the corner. That's probably a more pragmatic way of looking at it. Not everybody is born with great visionary skills. That can be learned, that can be built over time, to be able to look around the corner, to be able to use research and trends and patterns in industry, patterns in technology, patterns in people, how people behave, how teams behave, and be able to see around the corner. None of us saw this around the corner, what's happening now with the pandemic. We are all on a very, very steep learning curve to figure out how to adapt. But ultimately, inspiring a shared vision requires us to get others excited about possibilities. Enlisting others is critical so that you have people behind you, that they're following you. Let's take a look at the behaviors under inspire a shared vision. Again, as you scan this list, take a look at least one of those that you think you're pretty good at. For example, I scan down and I see the big picture bullet point. Some people are really, really good at that. They can walk into a room, they can see the whole thing decorated, they can walk into a team, they can read all the behaviors, they can assess people's morale. Others of us have to really work much, much harder at that, at putting pieces together. And that's not good or bad, that's just a different kind of skill set. This doesn't mean you have to be a futurist or dream about global possibilities necessarily. You can start small by researching and taking small steps. Right, certainly all of us research things all the time, right, because of Google, and we're able to pick up our phone and do those kinds of things. That's certainly a way to do research. But I would say that's more of an incomplete view. Sometimes research and study requires us to go beyond a Google and whatever we find there, and requires us to do other things like talk to people and get coaching from others, and, you know, read an entire white paper or book or an entire thought process on something. And so I think that's really important when you think about building the skills around developing vision. I think a simple way to accomplish this is by adopting some new language. For example, one of the things I encourage managers to do is to talk about the future in optimistic ways. Hey, when we get better at that, then why don't we consider bringing in and talk to that department? Or, you know, I have an idea I'm working on. What thoughts do you have about joining me? Or those are the kinds of leadership skills, okay, and behaviors that tend to disarm or inspire or encourage people to join in dialogue with you. I want to share an example of somebody that I think is very inspirational. Her name is Wilma Mankiller, and she's the former chief of the Cherokee Nation. Wilma Mankiller worked through a lot of adversity in her life. In fact, she was born, I think, in the late 50s or mid-50s, and actually became a very compelling figure during the civil rights movement out on the West Coast in the 60s. She broke numerous barriers of race and gender and inspired an entire generation to see beyond their immediate problems. The problems that the Cherokee people had at the time of poor education, social injustice, and disorganized and ineffective tribal government. She did this really by winning the hearts and the trust of the people, by being relentlessly focused on the future. Isn't it encouraging when we're around people who are relentlessly focused on the future? Yes, we have to be grounded in the reality of today, but we have to save some of our energy for the possibilities of the future. She did this with faith and hope and optimism. When she won the trust of the people, she was able to immobilize a whole group of people. In fact, she not only improved the conditions of her own tribe, she improved the government relations between other tribes and the U.S. government. In 1998, she received the Presidential Medal of Honor from former President Clinton. I just think she was a remarkable leader and helped lead her people into a whole new future of possibilities. She is really inspiring to me, and hope she is to you too. So go research her and find out more about her. Now we're going to transition into the third practice. You can see how these practices are beginning to build on themselves, from role modeling and being able to see around the corner and get out of the normalcy of our lives and be able to be optimistic about possibility. Now, this third practice challenges the process. Here's where sequence really matters the most, I think. Can you imagine a new manager coming into your company? Lots of energy and lots of optimism and, you know, completely, hey, let's change this or let's try that. Changing a policy or improving a process, addressing a work team. Maybe there's low trust. One of the things that I think a lot of managers struggle with is they come in with all this energy, but they haven't necessarily done the other practices first. They haven't taken the time to really allow people to get to know them, to be clear about their values. And I always encourage people that are new to leadership roles to go on a listening tour. It's kind of a form of assessment. Is to go on a listening tour to people that they're going to work with, people in other departments, people in all directions in their organization. It's a way not only to listen about the thoughts, ideas, and concerns of people within the organization, it's a very excellent idea for the leader, the new manager, the new leader, to be very clear about what's important to them. Even if they don't know the landscape yet, they can still talk about what's important to them. Making things constantly better is a critical to organizational success. In fact, in healthcare and manufacturing, they call things like that continuous quality improvement and lead and other kinds of process improvement types of methodologies. Those methodologies, I've seen time and time again, they do not sustain unless you get the culture bought in. And part of getting the culture bought in are practicing these other behaviors prior to going in. Otherwise, it's going to feel like an audit to people. So let's look at the behaviors. Let's look at some of the more granular kinds of things that we can focus on to become good at this practice, challenging the process. It can be invigorating part of a leader's role, looking for ways to excel and innovate. That is a core value for me when I've led teams, is to pursue excellence. One of the things that I've had to be very careful about, however, is as in my excitement to change and update things, I have to be careful that I am not communicating perfectionism, because that is a whole different connotation that people react to. If people that have worked with or for me have felt like I'm being perfectionistic or micromanaging. But I expect a lot from people, and I'm willing to give a lot to people. But I also expect excellence from both of us. By asking what we can learn, or to tell somebody, here's what I'm learning, that is a great way to frame challenging the status quo. Again, you've seen people do that well and people not do it very well. Those of us sometimes that have struggled with not addressing the status quo, we want to change things, when we've been clunky, or we haven't had enough empathy, or we haven't done enough listening, those types of initiatives tend to struggle to get off the ground. And so this is the part of the leadership practice that I really want to emphasize as important to listen. Things to say, you know, words are powerful. How we say things, that's behavioral, all right? Hey, let's try this, or have you thought about that, or tell me how that's worked in the past. And not just saying it to try to be nice or friendly, but living out that sort of attitude is really what I'm talking about here. And you can see the behaviors here that help get us there. Let me share an example with you. I think one of our favorite places to visit for many of us is Starbucks. Back in 1993, a store manager in Santa Monica started experimenting with a coffee drink using a blender. But at the time, the company really didn't want to invest in blenders. And so she brought her own blender into the store and started making frozen drinks and handing them out and trying them out to some of the guests that were coming in. Later, this drink was going to be named the Frappuccino. Okay. Well, this caught on, and the rest is history. In fact, the Frappuccino changed the trajectory of the company that year in 1993 by bringing in customers who were not even normal coffee drinkers, especially in warm weather, summertime. Brought in a whole new segment to the market. In its first year alone, the Frappuccino accounted for 11% of its summer sales and helped push Starbucks stock to an all-time high at the time. There's other examples I could use from Starbucks and other kinds of places, but this was an employee who tried something and did something fun and really kind of got out of the box and tried different things. In these unprecedented times, I would encourage all of us to think outside the box. It's so easy for us to become insular and to just isolate and use this medium only to sort of stay connected to people, and it's very challenging. So I would encourage all of us to think of ways to get outside the box in our own personal lives, in our homes, in our families, certainly in our workplaces. Let's move on now to the fourth leadership practice, which is enable others to act. The placement of this practice is important to acknowledge without the other practices proceeding, because ultimately you can't delegate and empower and assign tasks to others. You can with title and authority, but you can't do it in a way where it's going to just sustain engagement and productivity over time. Okay, so I'm in a room and the lights just went out, so I'm gonna try to wave my hand here. I think that you all can still hear and see me. Yes, Sherry, is that right?
We can see you, yes.
It's some of these challenges,
all good.
In the virtual environment. I may need some help. All right, my notes. So without the practices preceding that, it's very difficult to enable others to act, to get others to follow you, to build trust among others is really how leaders maximize the work effort. That's how you create synergy with teams. That's how you get high trust and high productivity and high quality. Look to any great service organization and you will see employees giving their, what I call discretionary effort, the above and the beyond. You know, and not just work hours. Sometimes it certainly means that, evenings or weekends or other kinds of things, but the above and beyond discretionary effort. That is the key in getting others to join in and getting them involved in the vision you've set as a leader. Let's look at some of the behaviors. under this practice. Again, as you scan this list, pick one of those that you think you're pretty good at. Maybe you're really good at being cooperative and developing cooperation and teamwork among other people. I've seen lots of leaders who are excellent managers, but they're not specifically good at listening. They've got their wheels are turning, they're thinking about other things, they're distracted, they're on their phone. They're great people, but they've really allowed distraction and competing priorities to diminish their ability to truly listen to other people, especially different points of view. In the workplace, that's very important. In our society, it's very, very important. And by being an excellent empathic listener is mostly what people want. They want to feel heard. For many of us, active listening to diverse points of views takes lots of work. So I would encourage us to think about one or two of these behaviors that you might say, hey, that's something I can get better at through my own personal research and study, and especially if I get into a program like one of the ones we're offering here at SMU. I've seen so many people come through these programs over the years and really kind of come out on the other end, pretty transformed, really having been around and among other professionals and peers, sharing stories and sharing opportunities to learn and really sharpening one another. It's really a great opportunity to get good at some of these behaviors. It's really going to help you grow in your career. So I want to share another example with you in this specific practice from a person named Mike Abershoff. He's a retired commander of a U.S. Navy ship, the USS Binfold. He became well known for taking command of this ship and basically leading it from one of the last ships in terms of quality and measurement and different types of things that they use to measure the effectiveness of the ship to being the first in the Navy. Some of those measures were around quality and financials and staff retention. In fact, he would say in his book that, you know, he could come in and use the sort of chain of command to tell people what to do and give orders, but he couldn't tell them to stay. And specifically during his time of service, the sailors would come into the Navy and they would stay for a certain amount of time. They would probably get some benefits, or they would get the college benefit or those kinds of things, and then they would leave. And so one of the things that was very disruptive and very costly is having a lot of turnover. What he began to do is to address this by taking a non-traditional approach to getting his crew to want to stay on the ship and want to be a part of it, and begin to want to see that, hey, this is your ship. In fact, that's the name of the book. It's your ship. Again, I encourage you to go, you can go Google this guy. You can go look at some YouTube videos of him. He's got some really cool talks that he's given. He literally spent countless hours within his first few months interviewing each and every crew member. Listening was the key to getting at really what was going on and why there was so much turnover. He found that there was a lot of bureaucracy. He found there was a lot of infighting between department heads, you know? And so he started the bottom up, listening to people, listening to their ideas, and ultimately empowering them to do something about it. One story he tells about a crew member who, when he interviewed them, complained about having to paint the ship once a year, which was very expensive, and battleship gray. And so he began to really find out more and more about why do we do this every year? Because of the salt water. It would rust a lot of the parts, a lot of specifically the nuts and the screws and that were connecting the different parts of the ship. Upon listening further, he found out that it was just the screws that really needed to be addressed and replaced. And so he empowered the sailor to go about doing that, replacing them with stainless steel parts. And lo and behold, it ended up saving not just the ship a lot of money, but the Navy millions of dollars, because everyone adopted that practice across the entire fleet. One sailor's idea by listening and not getting lost in the bureaucracies of chain of command. Commander Abershoff was brilliant at that. He commanded authority, but he did it not just by being a nice guy, but by listening to others and being able to affirm their concerns and be able to draw out their good ideas, because they were in the trenches and they saw where the problems really were. We're going to transition now to the last practice, Encourage the Heart. Now, that's an interesting title for a practice. I love that title of Encourage the Heart. It's really much more than recognition. It is recognition. It's the practice or practice of recognizing individual contributions and appreciating individual excellence. It's the practice of celebrating those and doing those victories, but it really comes from an attitude. Think back a few moments ago when you identified somebody you would be willing to follow. I guarantee that person is probably somebody who's very good at this, very good at encouraging you, maybe speaking truth and maybe saying hard things sometimes, but doing it in such a way that was caring and really was incented you to grow as a person, to grow as a leader. In fact, I think this practice probably is the most overlooked and underutilized practice for managers. And it's really the simplest in concept to understand, but sometimes it's the most difficult to be consistent at doing. One of the reasons is I think managers think that, well, I don't want to be insincere and just say thank you all the time, and I want it to be authentic and sincere. What I would encourage you to consider is sometimes our style, the way we talk to people, the way we treat people, is a part of this. I've seen smart, really good intention managers miss the mark on this because, again, they don't have the balance of getting the work done and caring for people along the way and finding that balance. And that's all I'm talking about here. I'm not talking about being touchy-feely. I'm not talking about kumbaya. I'm talking about making sure that you authentically pay attention along the way to how you're treating, how you're speaking to people, especially under stress, especially during these stressful times. You probably have noticed people's kindnesses coming during these kinds of times. You probably also, as I have been sometimes, sensitive to when people have not been empathic or they haven't listened very well. In fact, according to the Gallup research, employee engagement and recognition, specifically recognition, pats on the backs and thank yous and things like that, only have a shelf life of 7 days. That's a challenge for me because I think I'm pretty good at this practice, but I have to remind myself in all kinds of ways. I put reminders in my calendar. I have notes on my desk. I have all sorts of techniques I've picked up over the years to make sure that I'm consistently trying to encourage people, listening to them, and specifically giving them opportunities to feel heard and listened to. Let's talk about some of the behaviors around Encourage the Heart. One of the most important things you can do is not just say good job or job well done, but specifically say the impact of the job that they did. Hey, when you stayed late on Friday night, which I know you had a lot going on, but you stayed about an hour later on Friday night and you helped with that specific part of the presentation, it helped me because I had to finish my part over the weekend and prepare for the board meeting on Monday. That's actually a true story of a coordinator that worked with me at some point, and she kind of went above and beyond on this presentation, and there was a lot at stake in presenting to the board. It had to do with healthcare benefits, and she just went above and beyond. And when I told her, not just thank you, but here's the impact it had on me and the presentation, and this is how well it went because of your good work, that was gold. That just filled her up. She was not only felt good about her job, she also, it increased her confidence. So as you scan this list here, consider ways in which you can do this well and do it consistently. Again, not just because you have a title. Maybe you're an individual contributor, maybe you're part of a team. You can give recognition to peers. You can give recognitions to people that supervise you. You can give recognition to people in all directions and make that part of your communication and work style. And I promise you, it will pay off in dividends. People will come to see you as someone who is grateful and as someone who pays attention and notices the work and hard work of others. So the last example I want to share around this specific practice is Richard Branson. Now, Richard's an interesting person in the public view. I'm not sure how much you know about him. You've seen him on TV, you've seen him interviewed. He owns lots of companies, I think 400 companies under the umbrella of Virgin Companies. But the reason I wanted to share this example is because even with somebody who's in a public view, we've got different perceptions of like, dislike, what have you. there's something about him that people consistently that work within his organization say about him. And he's known for being an approachable, kind person. He interacts with not just executives, but paying customers and people from all over the organization at all levels in a very, very consistent way. In fact, in one interview, he describes that people are promoted not just for their specific skills or their expertise, but how they treat other people. That is a hallmark. That's going back all the way to the very first practice of model the way of somebody who, in this situation, from his employee's point of view, treats people fairly and kindly. One quick story that he told in an interview was that he was interviewing a group of people, one of his new companies he had launched. He was interviewing them and he had them come in. They flew in from different parts, I guess, of the country. And he put on a disguise. He disguised himself as an elderly, like a 90-year-old taxi driver. I'm sure that's probably something that you'd see on TV, right? He disguised himself as an elderly person. And when they came to get their luggage, he noticed how the people, this group of five people interacted with him, how they treated with him. And what he noticed is that several of the people declined the help from the elderly taxi driver and carried their own bags. And there were a few that didn't, that just sort of went on about their business. And he was kind of probably acting this out and struggling and stumbling and everything with these bags. And he later said that, you know, we spent an entire weekend with these people, and I'm not sure how he revealed his disguise, but at some point he must have. But ultimately, he chose and hired the people that carried their own bags. So it's just a kind of an example, a very creative example of how we watch not just what people say, but what they do and how they treat others. And I thought that was kind of an interesting story that I wanted to share with you. In closing, I would wish that you would just consider a few of these behaviors we've talked about today that you want to work on. Maybe something piqued your interest, you want to do some more research. In a moment, certainly we're going to take some questions from you, and we'd love to share some correspondence with you as well, even beyond today. But I hope that you will lean into and really encourage you to look at some of these ways in which you can grow as a leader and grow as a confident leader and build your skills. Thank you so much for joining us today. I think Sherry has some additional information she wants to share, and then we'll both be available for any questions you may have.
Thank you, Jeff. That was really good. I do have a question that's come up, and it relates to this topic. So how would you measure the effectiveness of using these practices? For example, if you're walking through them every day, I mean, how do you know if it's working on the people around you?
That's a great question. I think some of the quantitative measures is simply productivity and quality of the work. However, I think that would be an incomplete way to think, okay, this is working. I think the qualitative way, sort of the interpersonal ways, is what is the level of trust and rapport and interpersonal communication? Is that well? Is it fluid? Is it healthy? Do you have a sense of whether that person is committed to their role and staying in their role? In other words, can you retain them? Do they want to stay and grow in the role? Typically, retention measures and engagement measures are the best way to tell whether these practices are working.
That's great. Thank you. Here's another question. Can you describe some of the participants in the program, the type of
great
individual
question
that comes through?
Kerry and I both can probably do that. I think in the Transformational Leadership Program, I think that's targeted more towards sort of the director level. Mm-hmm. I think some of the concepts are a little more complex, and I think it's most valuable when you've had more experience supervising others, because a lot of the work and the practical work and the group work is around sharing some of your stories around that. I think the fundamentals of management, the other class, are for either individual contributors or people that are newer to management.
Good. Thank you. So if you have other questions that pop into mind as we wrap up today, please go ahead and put them in the chat window. And then at the end, know that we will be sending out the slide deck for everyone, as well as the recording will live on our website. So refer back to some of this if you don't remember the name of the book that he recommended you read. But at this point, we're going to just talk a little bit more about these two programs, and then I'll just wrap up with the calendar that we have that we're rolling out for fall. So the faculty that we use in the programs are both full-time and part-time Cox faculty. We also use affiliated facilitators, and those are subject matter experts in their area, for example, the kind of work that Jeff does. And so when we're talking about change management or we're talking about having difficult conversations, we're able to bring in a specific faculty that can address those. In terms of the kinds of modality that we use for learning, there is pre-reading, cases, and stories. So we try to send these out a week in advance for those who are traveling or those that just need to get a little head start on it so that the discussion in the classroom is richer. We're also going to do some application exercises in the classroom, group work, simulations. There'll be demonstrations and individual reflection. I think this is one of the best parts of our Tuesday night programs is that you're meeting once a week for 10 weeks. And so you are able to really apply some of the tools that you learn right away, reflect on those tools. And then when you meet back in the classroom, we do what's called pull the red thread, which is that we really try to talk about what worked in your scenario, how those techniques were applied, and then you're actually learning from the other participants about what they used and how they applied it. So in terms of what you can actually learn and what you're able to apply right away, so we'll talk about both of these programs, the Fundamentals of Management program, which we discussed, and the Transformational Leadership program, which Jeff teaches in, are both grounded in an actionable development plan, which is what we put out at the very beginning, so that you're able to journal your takeaways throughout the 10 weeks and really help those tactics stick. We also encourage this to grow as a manager. You will gain a positive approach to people and to problem solving. You're going to learn to implement strategies from evidence-based research on today's most valued management topics. And in terms of the transformational leadership class, we are working on helping you perfect a style that works for you. Enhancing your capacity to understand and to implement change. And that's a topic that I think is going to really live with us this year in 2020. And to gain a positive approach to leading people and enhancing your value to the organization. So all of the strategies we present are from evidence-based research on these topics. So in terms of who should apply, we talked a little bit about this for the transformational leadership, but starting with our fundamentals of management class, it is those who are managers or aspiring to be managers. A lot of the individuals that come into the program are in the engineering and the IT space and in some of the energy space. And these are individuals that are targeted for promotion. And on the transformational leadership class, it's director level and above, and succession candidates, and those that are wanting to take their leadership to the next level. And so the next slide here talks about the key dates involved. We're going to kick it off September 8th with transformational leadership. That's the second one listed. And then we'll begin fundamentals of management on September 15th. I want to mention also that we are launching this year the Cox Leadership Academy. And that is a program that's a 6-month leadership program for vice presidents and above. And its special feature of this program is one-on-one coaching. So you are actually paired with a private coach through the 6 months, and you are working with a team on an action learning project at the end. So we're excited to launch that this year. And if you do have interest in this program, reach out to us at the end of the sessions. So again, this is our fall calendar. We have 4 programs launching in September, 3 in October, 2 in November, and year-round we offer these type of topics to our corporate clients where we work with them to develop specific custom programs that meet the needs of their leadership development teams. And so we do both the open enrollment and the custom programs here in our executive education group. I also want to mention that, we're very cautious of the COVID environment that we're in right now. And so all of our programs for the fall, while we are encouraging students to come to the classroom, we are also offering a online live option. So if you are more comfortable for any reason from a Zoom standpoint, you can still participate in the class. There will be group discussions, there'll be breakout rooms, and it will be a very, very interactive experience as well. So at this point, I'm going to wrap it up for today, and I thank you for joining us. I have Dr. Luigi Pecoraro's contact information up here as well. He is the academic director for both the Fundamentals of Management and the Transformational Leadership class, as well as the Cox Leadership Academy. And he and I both work together as business developers to try to help you guide you to the right programs for this session. So at this point, I'm going to open it up for any questions. If anybody has any questions that they would like to add or shoot those into the Q&A box. Let's see, I don't have an open question yet, but I do see that someone raised a hand. So, but do feel free with our contact information here, we will be sending out the slide deck at the end of the session, and you'll be able to reach back to us with any specific questions that you have that we can address for these programs. Here it is. Okay, do we register the same if we do the Zoom setting? Yes, you would, because you would register on our website for the program, and then we will be reaching out to everyone shortly before the program starts to see if you are coming to campus or if you'll be attending via Zoom. So we will have a Zoom link available for every program that we're offering. Hope that answered your question.
Any more questions about the content today or the program opportunities? We'd be happy to chat with you about that.
So if there, you do have thoughts, again, please shoot me an email. I can reach Jeff and he can ask program specific questions about the five practices. Or if you have questions about any of the other programs we have on our website, we'd be happy to answer those. So we'll give you about 10 minutes left in your day. Thank you very much for joining us today. And we hope to see you on campus or virtually on campus in our programs in the fall. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a great day.
Have a great day.